It's harvest time. My goal over the next 3 or 4 weeks is to do everything I can to equip us for what we need biblically to prepare us for the harvest, all right? I want to prepare this church to be ready in a season of harvest. And so in this series, I'm going to touch on a few things. I'm going to touch on the fact that God wants to implant within us compassion. I believe that God wants to motivate us with a sense of urgency. God wants to remove every obstacle and hindrance to bringing in the harvest. And mostly, I believe God wants to empower us by the Spirit of the living God. Do you believe that today? I believe it with all my heart. How many of you believe that God has an abundant harvest prepared for Fountain of Life Christian Center? Amen. If you're believing God for harvest, I need somebody to make some noise in the house today. Amen. Amen. Are you believing for harvest in your family, harvest in your personal walk, harvest in our community, souls coming to Jesus, healings taking place, hearts being mended, grace being extended, marriages being restored? Oh, come on. I believe it's harvest time. Amen. As you can see, I'm ready to preach today. I love it. Years ago, Peanuts comic strip. How many of you remember that? Charlie Brown. All right. Well, Lucy and Linus and Charlie Brown are laying on their backs looking up at the sky. And Lucy says, "You can see a lot of things in the clouds." And then turning to her companion, she asks, "What do you see, Linus?" And Linus says, "Well," he said, "those clouds up there look to me like the map of Belize, the little nation in the Caribbean." And glancing in the other direction, he says, "That cloud looks a little bit like the profile of Thomas Eakins, the famous painter and sculptor. And that cloud formation over there gives me the impression of the stoning of Stephen. Well, I can even see Saul of Tarsus standing to one side." Lucy's like, "Wow. What do you see, Charlie Brown?" And this is what he said, clearing his throat. He said, "Oh, I was going to say I saw a donkey and a horsey, but I've changed my mind." Then we smile at Charlie Brown, right? He was looking, but he just didn't see everything that there was to see. Hello? Yeah. And what is true of Charlie Brown may be true of the Christians in the world today. We look at things, but we don't see everything that there is, right? And I just believe that God wants to do something within us where He opens up our eyes so that we can see what He has for us. Amen. The harvest. How many have John chapter 4? Did you bring your Bible? Hold it up. If you got an e-book, a tree book, it don't matter. Amen. It says John chapter 4, verse 34. Jesus said to them, "My food." Everybody say food. Food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to finish His work. Do you not say, there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the field, for they are already white for harvest. Now, most of us aren't from an agrarian society, but what we do know is that as you look at a field of wheat that's ready to harvest, it's golden color, right? Yeah. And then just before the wheat starts falling off into the ground and the harvest is lost, the little chaff on the outside of the wheat turns white color. And so what Jesus was saying is, look, man, someone's got to get that harvest in or it's going to be gone, right? Let's continue on there in the Word. It says that he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. And so we know that there's a rejoicing that comes when it's harvest time. Can we just pray today? Heavenly Father, I pray that you would take this simple message today and anoint it in a powerful way, I pray, God. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would prepare your people. And as I reach out by faith and touch your people with this message, God, I pray that it would be your fingerprints that are left upon them in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. As we begin looking here at John chapter 4. By the way, this is a powerful chapter. Jesus, this is a story in this chapter, true event that really happened, where Jesus won a soul to himself, a Samaritan woman. And there's something we need to realize, that the Samaritans weren't too popular with the Jews, okay? Most Jews would go around Samaria rather than go through it, all right? There was a lot of racial tension between these groups of people. And you know, when we think of a Samaritan, we think of the story, right, about the good Samaritan, right? Almost everybody, even in the world, says that's a good Samaritan. But let me tell you, in those days, there was a lot of contention, a lot of debate. They were kind of like distant, strange cousins that nobody wanted to acknowledge. And there was all this controversy over where they worship and how they worship. But the scripture tells us this about Jesus, that Jesus needed to go to Samaria. Let me read that scripture for you. John 3, verse 3 and 4 says, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, but he needed, the scripture says, to go through Samaria. He needed to go through Samaria. And other versions actually say that he had to go through Samaria. So I'm certain that when Jesus told his disciples, we are on our way to Samaria, I'm certain that they were wondering, why are we doing this? Who cares about the Samaritans? But you know, it was necessary for Jesus to go. And I'm going to tell you up front that Jesus did it for two reasons, all right? Let me give you the outline up front, all right? First of all, he went because there was a thirsty woman there. She was thirsty for something, and she didn't really know what it was, but she was looking for something her whole life, and she needed it. And she needed to drink of the living water that satisfied her. And then the second reason why he had to go, he went because his disciples were hungry. Now, his disciples were hungry, and they didn't know it. They needed to learn how to eat of the same food that Jesus ate of that day. And so what's interesting about this entire chapter, it's all framed in the idea of being thirsty and hungry. Now, how many of you know that we eat and drink to satisfy those natural desires, right? Who's ever been really thirsty? Oh, man, doesn't water taste so good when you're thirsty? Oh, just plain old water. And who's ever been really hungry? I mean, when you're really hungry, anything will taste good, you know? I mean, rice chips is like a treat when you're hungry. You know, I mean, when you're, and let me tell you, we have got to learn how to satisfy the spiritual side of our hunger and our thirst. And how many of you know that Jesus is the one that satisfies? Did you know that the word says this? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. If you're hungry, he's the bread of life. Come on. He said, I am the living water. If you're thirsty, he's the living water. So I just want to jump in today, and I want to explore these two themes today. And I want to encourage us, as it says in John, once again, to lift up your eyes and look at the field that they're white already for harvest. So if we're going to be prepared, first of all, we need to be able to see